our first face-to-face event actually since the pandemic. So we are happy to see everyone, whatever we can see of you. We have half of you all masked, but good to see everyone. So I would particularly like to thank the Honorable Finance Minister for, you know, doing this event. It's always a challenge to, you know, during a, just after a pandemic, to decide that I want to interact with the public, and we are delighted that, you know, she agreed to do this town hall fireside chat event with you all. This has really been an unprecedented time for the country. The pandemic is something like what happened, you know, over a 100-year period. It's again a sort of a recurrence of something. High unemployment during the period. You had, you know, GDP growth down, and so it's really a tough time in which to steer the economy and to present a budget. But it was an opportunity for doing some audacious things, and they were very much there in the budget, whether one looks at it in terms of the decisions around health, the decisions to spend on primary, secondary, tertiary health upgradation, or to do the rollout of the vaccination program, the decisions on public infrastructure, the, you know, textile parks, or whether to do national highways in certain regions of the country, and to set up also a DFI to fund infrastructure. And finally, the decision to actually privatize in the big bang way in which it has been actually envisaged. So we are living actually in a city which since yesterday has been captured by the imagination of cricket. And this is really a, you know, in that sense, you know, a strong hit to the boundary of economic growth. And if there is anything, you know, that will stop that strong hit to the boundary, you know, it could just be another variant of the pandemic, or it could be, you know, unfortunately, these rating agencies who are trying to sort of, you know, pull, you know, keep the ball from the boundary. Okay? So without much ado, this is going to be an interaction with two of our students. There's Anurabh out there who is PGP2, and there is Sonakshi. The two of them are going to, you know, lead this conversation with the Honorable Finance Minister. Before we get into the conversation, I would like to, you know, take the opportunity to, you know, present a small thing from the Institute.
Corporate bond markets have sort of narrowed, and this is a major hurdle for our relative to global companies. So is the government thinking about sort of deepening the credit markets as well, so as to wean the companies away from bank credit? So on these two points.
Yes, the second one first. Yes, we are planning, and this is not post the pandemic budget, but even before that, from July 19, we've been very clearly putting forward every step that is required to deepen the bond market in India. And the result is already visible for all of us to see. Many Indian companies are raising their resources from the markets. In fact, public sector banks themselves have gone. The customary practice and I suppose the way in which it worked all this while was for the public sector banks to get the equity from the government. Once the infusion is done, they definitely look at using majority of it for growth and some of course to do the necessary provisioning and so on. So public sector banks, I would have thought, would be hesitant to go, but they have proved more than one or two times that they are capable of going out and they are raising good monies for themselves. So today it's quite a certain vibrancy, and also the way in which the G-Secs are now available for retail participation. Some would say it was already available and they were, retail participation was never stopped. But retail investors to think in terms of AI is taken is also one step forward in making it possible for retail investors to think in terms of funding government for the G6. So that partly answers your first question also, that the crowding out is not the thing now because there's liquidity awash in the market, in the economy, and it is now also a question of how effectively and how quickly that's being sucked out, not by the Reserve Bank so much, but effectively brought into the debt market so that the bond markets and the yields are also influenced by the fact that today or yesterday, I think there has been a lot of write-up about there probably isn't that kind of an appetite for. But that is not the question. The question is, government's borrowing is announced well in time as per a calendar it goes. So there is a certain predictability and a certain stated number about it. So markets are very tuned in, clued into this. So they know to reorganize themselves. And I don't think in a year where you have liquidity in abundance and there is clear borrowing plan with a calendar attached to it by the government, crowding out will be an issue. Because if they weren't, there wasn't adequate liquidity, but yet the government is on a borrowing spree, then you know you're rushing in to get that little resource which is available. You from government, private sector as it is, and everybody comes in and you tend to crowd out because you're the government and you take it away. But today, liquidity being what it is, and also many of the Indian companies are finding it easier to go and borrow from outside. So that leaves a bit more available within the country.
Thank you, ma'am. Switching gears now to the education sector, the budget has seen a 6.1% decline in the educational outlay, and this comes in the backdrop of the new education policy being brought in. So we would like to understand the rationale of the government behind this decline, and what steps will the government be taking to ensure quality education for the youth of the country?
Now, I know it's not the parliament for me to stay. No, your numbers are wrong. This is it. I wouldn't do that. I'm sure for health and for education, there was considerable time spent, health because of the pandemic, health also because India's health infrastructure needed, pandemic, no pandemic, needed that boost. also infrastructure. So on all these three counts, health received a lot of attention and a sure shot increase in the numbers. So was education. Also because in the last couple of years, there has been this desire to bring in a lot of digital learning. There's been a lot of desire to make education not just brick and mortar schools. There's also been, at a higher education level, this desire for twinning even as you're graduating in one particular place, with a university somewhere else. So, not just in higher education, but also in secondary and primary schools, we wanted to make sure the spread of optical fibers at the panchayat level would also give that additional benefit to the schools. So there has been a conscious attempt to improve the funding to education. Now, if you were to categorize them under heads and see, maybe there will always be, a question of no, but that many number of schools got constructed last year, this year. So there is always bound to be head-based calculation. But I would want to underline the fact that the new education policy, the schemes under it, meaning the schemes which can come under it, and the long-term vision with which the new education policy looks at making Indian education a lot more vibrant, has received due consideration in the budget-making process.
Thank you for that, ma'am. I think we'll keep zigzagging between macro issues and social issues of the budget. So we just wanted to come to the divestment and privatization plan which is there in the budget. So, I mean, really impressive target set by the government for FY22. And just two clarifying questions around that. First is that the range of PSUs that have been sort of been selected for divestment, they range from like highly profitable entities like BPCL and Concor and all the way down to IDBI and Air India. And we have missed divestment deadlines even for the first two several times in the past. So I know the last year we missed the target by a wide margin, maybe because of COVID, but is the government confident of achieving the divestment target in the timeline this year? And the second is, ma'am, it's not as if privatization has always helped. We've seen this in the experience of banks as well in India. So can we think about separating ownership from operational control, getting professional management? And here we could maybe take a leaf out of Singapore and China's book, where the state-owned enterprises, originally they were inefficient, then later they actually started disrupting, and now they have successfully globalized as well. So around these two, what is your thinking around these two points?
Again, the second one first. Absolutely agree with you. We are not on a spree to get out of every public sector. Let that be very plain. And the policy, when it was announced, of course, clearly identified those which can be called strategic core sectors. It listed out such sectors as atomic energy, space, power, banks, telecommunications, and so on. And even in that listing, we said private will still be allowed to come in all those which have been listed as core and strategic. But even after that, the presence of public sector is not going to be totally removed. Bare minimum presence at least will be there. So, as much as a privatization statement it is, just read it again, you'll know that public sector and its presence, and its presence in a big scaled up way, and its presence in a professionally run way is what we are paving the way for. So when we list out those sectors where the bare minimum presence will be, we are also saying for a growing India, for a new India, for a youthful India, for an India with 2/3 of young population, just the public sector is not going to be sufficient to meet with the growing demands. So the bare minimum presence that we are talking about is going to ensure a big, scaled up, large, bare minimum presence. In the sense, even if they are one or two or three, whatever the bare minimum is for that particular sector of activity, it'll be a public sector undertaking of a good solid presence. So it is a commitment from our side to ensure that you're going to make professionalized, well-managed, well-endowed public sector undertakings which will be nimble in their operation. So your point about Singapore being quoted is well taken. But we do recognize if only there are particular public sector undertakings in those sectors which are given the due consideration, professionalized, running independently, and be able to stand up for competition too. Those will be the public sector undertakings which will serve the purpose for their presence. So that is the policy. And therefore it is not continuing with, pardon me for the expression, laggard PSUs and then feeling very sacred about them. Oh, sorry, public sector, you don't touch it. No, they can't be laggard and be public sector also, because what runs them? Public money runs them. Taxpayers' money runs them. And people who sit there and take the decision are taking it for the people. The organizations are people-owned. So why can't they be professionalized? And therefore, as much as it speaks about privatization, it also speaks about well-run, professionally managed, absolutely meeting the challenge of the day kind of public sector undertakings. So both your questions get answered in a way. Am I right? What was the second?
The first question, like, we have a very ambitious divestment target.
Yes,
so
come to that. So this aspect that, yes, we are taking care of public sector undertakings as well, but privatizing some of them. And the list that you referred to are not only not so well performing PSUs, but some of them are good PSUs, which are profit making PSUs. But the principle being this, we want more of them to be run efficiently, and some can go over to the private sector. So that is the selection criteria. It wasn't for only the loss making ones. Yes, we didn't achieve our targets, not just last year, but even the year before. Last year, you can always say it's COVID, you couldn't have done it. And the year before it, I'm answerable because economy was slowing down. There was no appetite in the market for any of your disinvestment. There was no momentum yet for that kind of a purchase. So no hesitations in saying, yes, I couldn't achieve the target. But now when the appetite is probably better, and even during the pandemic when the stock markets were doing well, and now they're doing better, even better after the budget, I've come up with a realistic number. I've not given an overestimated number. So I'm sure to achieve it.
Thank you, ma'am. We are really looking forward for a strong implementation of the disinvestment target. Moving forward, out of the many bright spots in the budget, the increase in health expenditure has been one of the brightest in our opinion. However, in the health expenditure, 35,000 crore and also some amount of it has been directed towards the sanitation drive as well as the COVID vaccine distribution. So we were curious whether this increase in health expenditure is here to stay and how the government is planning to implement the entire COVID vaccine drive as well.
Were you in any state government before? Is it here to stay? I hope the vaccine component at least is not here to stay. And you wouldn't disagree with me on that. Because yes, we need to give for the vaccine. I don't want it to be continuing next few years. Fully utilize it. More is available if you need it for vaccine. Yes. But that component obviously is not something which can be held every year after this. But the commitment to have more given for health I think India will sustain that interest in budget making, during budget making, and for provisioning. We need that kind of investment in health infrastructure. It's a different argument altogether to say that there were state countries abroad which had very well networked health infrastructure, but even they bore the brunt of the pandemic. But that's not an argument to say, so don't have proper infrastructure for health. It is all the more to say, for a country like India, with the density of population being what it is, and for a country of India's nature of income disparity being what it is, we can't but invest more in health infrastructure. And when I say health infrastructure, not just building hospitals, but in creating more institutions which will ready doctors, nurses, and paramedical staff as well. So this budget, somewhat different from every other budget earlier, did not look at just, you want more AIIMS, take it. You want more hospitals, take it. This budget has looked at, yes, more AIIMS, probably more of non-AIIMS, but hospitals yet, because super speciality hospitals like AIIMS are required, no doubt. But you also need a lot more primary healthcare centers. You also need a lot more tertiary healthcare sectors. You also need a lot more, not super speciality, but hospitals in districts. Hospitals where people will go as a first point of call. Discourage this attitude of having to rush to AIIMS like hospitals everywhere, instead of going to your first point of call, which should be a primary health center. If only the primary health centers are endowed better and have more of general practitioners, more of the kind of facilitation that you need for diagnosis, then this rush, which can be avoided in super specialty hospitals, can be avoided. And therefore, we are giving a priority to bringing in wellness centers, bringing in district level hospitals which can take care of special virology related illnesses also, bring in institutions which will have testing labs. Remember, during the pandemic, I don't think it'll be inappropriate to say it now, at the very start of the lockdown, we had only two places in the country where you could send the samples for testing for the virus itself. But the pandemic has told us now more virus testing centers, and as a result of testing and as a result of repeated RT-PCRs, you are able to contain the spread of the virus itself. So the budget actually has gone to that specificity to say we need more virus testing centers at the district level, bring them in. So the infrastructure is not just going to be brick and mortar, AIIMS like large super speciality, but you will have wellness centers, you have primary healthcare centers, more testing labs, and more virology like centers which can analyze the various types of viruses which may in the future shock us. So it has now taken a holistic approach, I would like to believe, of preventive healthcare, curative, and also wellness. We've made provision for all the three, and because we've made the provision for all the three, you find preventive justifying the bringing in of sanitation, water management into health budget. Although it will still remain in the various ministries where they are now. So when some opposition parties asked me what justifies bringing sanitation into health, because we've taken this holistic approach. And as a result, I would think this is not something which is going to happen only this year. It shall continue. This commitment to improve on health budget will continue.
Thank you, ma'am. We are glad to be assured of the government's commitment towards a healthy India in the coming future as well. Moving on towards Skill India, the government seems to be enhancing human capital in the country through short-term skill training programs. However, what is your view on the progress of this on the demand side? Are these skilled students actually employable by the companies? And how is the government planning to increase employability potential for
we've taken a one-size-fit-all kind of an approach in this. And I'm answering more with what I've heard from the ground. When I go to these small MSME associations, and that is probably during the pandemic and after that also, these associations have come forward to train high secondary students, engineering students, post their engineering certification, training in their own setup. That cluster could be a, I don't know, small and medium sector industry cluster, or it could be a big time, you know, aero engine component manufacturing cluster, or it could be a textile mill which is essentially into producing fabric and that cluster. So each of them have their own requirements for which they are happy to train their own future employees of different levels, as I said, from polytechnic, from schools, from engineering colleges and so on. So there is a participation from the government side also. And therefore, the approach to skilling varies like this. Or it could be even those migrant workers who have gone back to their villages during the pandemic, who took up to MNREGA-related works, the Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme-related works, whose requirement for upskilling themselves is at a different level. But even they who take up training take it up through some authorized centers which are not attached to their employers, future employers. So the approach is so different and diversified. I also find success in these clusters which are industry driven. Success far more in, let us say, if they train 500 people, they most often end up taking up 350 of them for their own units. The rest of them are quite qualified to move around the country wherever the job is available. That benefit I am yet to see. That's not to say it won't come. I'm yet to see in the skilling and upgrading of skills for those who have moved over back to their villages through a standardized training center. The long and short of what I'm trying to tell you is skilling when it is linked with industries, skilling which is driven by industry associations, is more specific to the point and is making ready. You said, are they getting employed? These fellows are getting employed far more successfully in far more bigger numbers than those which are getting standardized training. So that itself is a reiteration of a point which is also what drove us to make the budget the way we made it. Unless there is private sector participation in everything that the government does, the real change is going to be difficult to happen.
So, thank you for that, ma'am. I just wanted to...
Are my answers long? Are you getting fed up?
Not really.
I tend to talk with a longer explanatory answer. So, if you want a short one, tell me. I'll probably quickly give a bite and finish it.
We like the long answers, perfectly. So
he's too polite for conducting a program like this. Huh? He's got to be punchy a bit more.
So, actually, okay, I was just going to deliver a punch. So, I was just... I wanted to address the Dharam Sankat in the room because you have sort of alluded to this problem.
Yes,
before.
I did.
So, when is the government planning to reduce the cesses on fuel? Because, I mean, I go to the petrol pump and if I see triple digits for single litre, really sad.
I was too quick to say, no, that this guy lacks the punch. I won't be able to say when. It's a Dharam Sankat.
but a little more, ma'am. Our fuel prices, even when abroad, the fuel prices are going down, this is like a nice way of generating revenue. So, will that st- stance change? Because now, of course, oil futures are going up, prices will go up. So now this is still fine. But like earlier, when during the COVID pandemic, prices were down, fuel prices in India are still high. So this stance that, you know, you can milk the fuel cess to generate government revenue, will that change anytime?
Hey, it's not just the cess. You have an excise duty of the center. Then you have a VAT of the states, which are percentage driven. Yeah. We can bicker about who earns more. Even if you want to say, and you're right if you say, the center earns more. Everything that the center earns, 40% of it goes to the states. So what I'm left with is only that portion, although the total amount is what you're saying. So there's just no hiding the fact that there is revenue there. There's just no hiding the fact. And it's not just me. You ask any state. There's revenue there. Just like, may not apply to Gujarat, just like, you know, there's revenue where? And in that state, center has nothing. So there is a revenue. There is a revenue consideration, both for the center and the states. And that is why I strongly believe it's no longer competitive. If the end consumer should pay less, and the burden should be less on them, and I agree there on that point, and I concede it also from the point of view of the pet point of, you know, more the fuel cost, more the inflation. You have many arguments. But it's no longer competitive for anyone to say, hey, center, you reduce first, then the states will come on board. They may or may not. If eventually we want the consumers not to be bearing on so much of a burden on this score, it is both the center and the states which will have to talk. I'm sure immediately our man is going to tell me, so when are they going to talk? When are you cutting down? Yes, I concede. That's where action has to be, and let's see what we can do about it.
Thank you, ma'am. Generally, defense as well as interest repayments constitute around 40% of budgetary expenditure, leaving little room for flexibility. At the same time, we have noticed that the government has increased its reliance on small savings schemes, which have a greater interest repayment than the bond yields in general. So how is the government planning to coordinate with the RBI in this matter? Because doing this might affect monetary transmission policies of the RBI as well.
No, I think this budget, we've made it very plain that our borrowings from, let us say, the National Savings Scheme Fund will at least be on the book. I'm not saying we won't borrow at all, but if it is put on the budget in government's accounting openly, everyone gets to seeing what is the extent of borrowing. And that's a very costly borrow. Why is it costly? Because the returns on NSSF is assured. And for me to maintain that, when I borrow from there, obviously I'll borrow at a higher rate. So there's actually a lot of incentive for government to borrow from anywhere else rather than from the NSSF. So if that logic is being appreciated, and with that appreciation we've brought this on to the book, we've already shown you that we are keen on going into the market and picking up at a market determined yield. So that itself gives an indication that we want the market forces to play on it rather than take it to my advantage each time. And once you decided to open up in that way, you are allowing fair play. You are allowing a certain justified approach to borrow. So justified approach to borrowing itself then assures the taxpayer that you're not borrowing at a high rate. So that, with the RBI understanding it, and you see that when we were borrowing back to back for the sake of the GST compensation, it's been absolutely at reasonable yields.
Thank you, ma'am. So we've already discussed upskilling and how it should be industry driven if you want the demand side also. So just last week, actually, the UK Supreme Court ruled against Uber, and they sort of mentioned that Uber's drivers are actually workers and they are fully entitled to benefits. So similarly, the budget has also mentioned the gig economy. So in this era of automation and shorter term jobs that are associated with the gig economy, how is the government thinking about upskilling such workers? A lot of rural workers migrate to the cities, have these jobs with very little security, and then they're basically on the ropes. So how are we thinking about upskilling these kind of people?
Upskilling and also providing a certain level of social security,
yes,
to
ma'am.
Them. In fact, the labor code, which is now passed, and the four of them, and the budget, as you rightly pointed out, has given a lot of consideration for the gig workers. There is definitely a set of factors which are coming into play, which you see that the industries are going through a lot of reset themselves. And when they are doing a reset, the business model that each of these businesses had earlier is going through a rapid change. When the reset is what is being talked about, you also hear from industry, quite a number of them who are now also getting into AI and robotics and so on, which is also going to have a bearing on the kind of recruitment that they will be doing. And if recruitment, the nature of recruitment is going to be moving towards that kind of a contractual work, then the question of not just skilling, but also social security is left wide open. And that's where we have made provision both in the labor codes so that even contractual workers will get as much benefits, as much assurances as would the old-fashioned permanent employee would get. We have ensured that that element is brought in into the labor codes. And on the social security, the budget referring to gig workers as gig workers wanted to bring in that dimension that today the economy is going to have to face challenges of these gig workers and their social security. And that is why, whether it's Ayushman, whether it is any kind of insurance that we want to give, we'll be giving them the priority.
Thank you, ma'am. The budget seemed to have chosen the path of greater investment in infrastructure over direct assistance to the vulnerable sections of the society. So what was the rationale behind this move, and what do you think is a better alternative?
How are you putting these two on the same platter?
In terms of the multiplier effect of infrastructure is what we are referring to here.
Yes.
So the multiplier effect for infrastructure has been given more priority over direct benefit to the poor sections of the society.
Multiplier
in terms
effect.
Of generating employment opportunity.
Multiplier effect is the answer. You put that answer in the question even as you ask me. When I spend money on the infrastructure, when I spend money on projects, that money goes proportionately into the hands of those who are getting jobs there. That money goes not when the project gets completed, but even as the project has been planned, even as the land is being cleared for the project, that money goes into the hands of the workers. So it is not as if it is this or that. It's not as if this and not that. It is actually this and therefore that also. That's the logic of choosing a multiplier giving area, which is a capex driven infrastructure building, asset creating, project funding from the government, which is resulting in not only the huge big asset which is going to come after the 3-year project time, but through the 3 years, the workers who are going to be engaged in it, and when I say workers, they are going to be unskilled, semi-skilled and completely skilled, and even the new collar workers coming in there. So that's going to run through the project tenure and after the asset is created in the project itself. So that is why we chose, and it is not as if this or that, this and therefore that also.
Thank you for that clarification. So I think it's generally acknowledged that women have been disproportionately affected because of the pandemic. And historically, the female labor force participation in the economy has been abysmally low. So we noticed that there's a huge thrust on textile parks, there's a huge thrust on PLI schemes, really upgrading the manufacturing. So are these towards increasing the female labor force participation? And if so, are there any other measures that the government is thinking about to solve this problem? Because we are really losing out on a lot of economic value here.
You're right, and I'm glad you're asking that question and not you. If that has any implication. Again, I'll just go very briefly back to the labor codes. We have made the labor codes in such a way that especially for women workers, all restrictions be removed, be allowed to work even in the nights, and when they're allowed to work in the nights, extra precaution on their security and safety be taken, and the usual pick up and drop with a proper background checked and whatever provision in transportation and logistics be taken care of, are embedded into the 4 labor codes which we've passed. And also when particularly, you're right in quoting the example of mega textile parks, not just textile parks, I would want you to include in every one of the PLI that we've given, the sectors that we've chosen, even as we chose the sectors and we were talking about it for extending the PLI to them, the impact on labor, the impact on women labor, you'll be glad to know, was discussed even as the project was being prepared to go to the cabinet. So there's a lot of thought, a lot of concern in the government, in the political executive, about bringing women to work, formal work, and making sure that the laws will be running in parallel to facilitate their participation. Otherwise, if you remember, well before Corona, we had extended women the maternity benefits, longer duration of maternity benefit being offered to them. We're all done even before. But now we see that together with the provisions given in the labor code and the decision on the PLI for the labor intensive units, for which for every additional unit production, they get a production linked incentive, are all those sectors in which women and their participation can be very, in fact, sometimes disproportionately large. And we're happy about that.
That's very heartening, ma'am. Thank you. So the next question is, there's been a lot of debate around the RBI's inflation targeting mandate, and some people say that instead of targeting headline inflation, they should be targeting core inflation, and some people are saying that they should just revise the mandate because right now growth is a priority and inflation is not. And if the RBI has to support the government's borrowing program so that the yields don't harden, they might have to take actions that are directly in contradiction with their inflation mandate. So what is your opinion on this?
I was just looking around. Just before coming here, there was a young economist who used to be in touch with me, who continues to be in touch with me, who has spent a lot of time studying inflation targeting. And whether in India today the inflation targeting is the one which the Western world has been talking to us about, and is that the way to go about it? And is India's growth, drive for growth and the impetus for growth got to be conditioned by your inflation targeting? know, he's gone into details of it, and it was very interesting talking to him just before coming here. He's one of the group of people who've been constantly working with us, and incidentally he was here, so he met me. So that's just to say, I'm not saying that that's the government's view, but interestingly he was talking to me about it. But one thing I would now say, speaking for this government and the government 2014-19, inflation under Prime Minister Modi has never gone beyond 4%. There was one occasion when, for various reasons, it touched 6, but has never been beyond that. And seasonal fluctuations of perishable commodities, which make up for a big constituent number of the basket which determines CPI and the basket which defines WPI. And incidentally, CPI inflation numbers go in one direction, and we have had the strange thing of WPI numbers relating to inflation going in a different direction at some points in time. But with all this, we've never allowed inflation to go beyond acceptable levels. Yes, seasonal fluctuations have happened, particularly on perishable goods. So inflation targeting has been managed well, and there's constantly this interaction with RBI on it. So,
thank you, ma'am. Yours has been a very inspiring journey. You've done your master's and MPhil from JNU, and this budget can be seen as one of the most market-friendly budget out there in the recent past.
I know what's coming.
Yes, ma'am. So while you represent the Bharatiya Janata Party, and your husband is from the Congress Party, we would like to know how you maintain this fine balance, and also any advice you have for the students of IIM Ahmedabad. We would love to hear from you, ma'am.
I was thinking, I was wrong actually. I thought I knew what was coming. No, I was wrong. I thought she would ask me, you're from JNU, how are you giving a privatization, more free market, more opening up for private sector kind of a budget?
Ma'am, I hinted towards.
Okay. No, I don't think it. This is something which I've had conviction, actually, and even on the campus, I've never veered towards, lots of people do say when you're young, you should be, something is wrong with you if you're not a communist. And when you grow, something is wrong with you if you're still a communist. People do say this. But probably something was wrong with me when I was in JNU. I was never towards communism or socialism. I didn't believe in it. I think I was very clear that individual enterprise needs the space. Legitimate profiteering cannot be, legitimate profit earning cannot be treated as evil. Every individual should find a space to do what he wants or she wants. And therefore this constricting system of the public good is determined by the government of the day and you cannot, I've never watched for that. So even in the campus, I was never towards the pink or the red. I was more towards the white free thinking. And coming into the BJP was very much consistent with the economic philosophy with which the BJP or the Jan Sangh before it was propagating. So I'm glad I'm doing that which is consistent with the belief, economic beliefs that I've had. And it's just such a beautiful coincidence that I'm not here doing something which I don't believe in it. I strongly believe in what I've done, and this is a strong belief is also the belief of the party in power. It's also the belief of the Prime Minister who was here doing many of these things in Gujarat. And I think, I strongly believe that the welfare of a large section of the population, welfare and public good, is certainly much more achievable when you give that space for individuals and enterprises to survive and do their businesses. There's no point in having a government which hard sells
regulatory quota license Raj, and I'm happy to be able to be the loudspeaker, if you want to say, we are getting out of license quota Raj, and we are giving trust into back to the people.
Thank you, ma'am, for those really passionate words. Your advice to the students of IIM Ahmedabad, we would love to hear that.
Not advice, but I think you're all so fortunate to be in an institution like this. So fortunate to be able to have such peer group and also a camaraderie among yourselves. I would only request you, not an advice, I would only request you, definitely at some point in time in life, spare some time for the country, spare some time for the nation to get stronger. Do your maximum best, build your careers, but there should be some time when you can spare it for the country. Everything that you do, yes, is for yourself, for the country indirectly, but directly do give some time for nation building. India needs all your support. We need a bright, smart, fantastic India.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think we have the time for a couple of questions from the audience.
Thank you for your thoughts, ma'am. I'm Piyush, I'm a PhD student here in economics area. We have discussed in detail about borrowing plans of the government. I have a question regarding the repayment plans. As Professor D'Souza here, incidentally, he's also from JNU, he mentioned about the credit rating agencies in the beginning. The current chief economic advisor has suggested in the economic survey that we don't need to bother about the ratings, and also the branches, Oliver Branch's statements that the debt to GDP ratio can go higher if the GDP growth is higher than the interest rates. But there are still many constraints regarding that. So, but the tax to GDP ratio and the revenue growth has been either stagnant or falling. This year we have seen negative growth in revenue generation. So how much are you going with the suggestion of the current CA regarding increasing the tax and having a sustainable repayment plans through revenue growth?
No, the budget is not giving any space for increasing tax. We have not contemplated on any increase in tax. We have not even brought in any new tax. So that's not been on the consideration at all. In fact, the Prime Minister was very clear, even as the initial stages of budget preparation started in October, that he wouldn't want any tax to be levied. He wouldn't want any additional rupee to be raised through any kind of taxation. So we were very clear on that. So in fact, I was surprised that in the media there were a lot of discussions about a COVID cess. I don't know where that came from. We didn't even consider that. But the question of debt to GDP, because we are doing many of the programs through borrowing, is because we made it very clear to ourselves that this year is when we need to spend. This year is when we want the stimulus to be adequate so that economy picks up faster. But yet, having done that kind of a spending, which will be sustained for some time, till the growth momentum is also well above any worries, sustained growth momentum once achieved, we have also shown a clear glide path for the fiscal deficit. So, in a way, answering that question, we have not allowed us to be worried about the ratings. But being a responsible government, I'll also have to show a path of how I'm going to bring that back to some kind of an acceptable level, having learned from what happened in 2008-09. Many steps taken by the government went without a closure. As a result, you had the taper tantrum. You also had this thing about, it was left open, the floodgates were left open, and much water had flown to the extent that the economy had the negative effect of it rather than just the trigger which was so required. So learning from that, we are very clear that we've already shown the path for getting a responsible prudential management.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Ashay Gupta. I'm a 1 year MBA student here. My question is primarily about policy in general and especially in education. So let's say even if we talk about BRIC countries, we see almost universal education. But India is probably a little bit lagging behind, which has been also brought forward in the national education policy, that how there are some kids which are out of school. And also across the state, we see a lot of disparity in terms of spending which is being done in education. So my question is that how can central government bring parity across the states and achieve that dream of universal education with quality? Let's say a kid in Bihar does not, or a kid in UP does not have to satisfy himself or herself with a subpar education compared to some other states. And the second question is about privatization of education, that right now, let's say education is more of a non-profit and, effort. Do you think that privatization, as you said, respectful profiteering in such sectors, which is considered public good as of now, can help bridge that gap as well? Thank you.
The new education policy has just come out. There's good reception for it. It's laid the path very clearly. We'll have to allow it time and space to show what it can bring us out. So at this point, I wouldn't want to speculate on aspects which are already covered by the education policy. But I think both center and states will be working together to address the first issue that you spoke about, the disparity and the dissonance between a child in a remote area as different from a child closer to the capital within a state, and in some states compared to the rest of other states. So that disparity will have to be addressed. They cannot be equal disadvantage or worse lack of advantage among children in India, and the new education policy does not definitely support that kind of a thing. So for that to be effectively seen in the ground, both the center and the states will have to work together to see how to bridge that gap.
Good evening, ma'am. Thank you so much for answering the question so patiently. So I'm Jyotsna, a second year food and agri business management student here. So I expected a discussion to revolve around this, but since it didn't, so I would like to bring this up. So we all understand that one of the major concerns of the farmer protesting at the border is regarding the MSP. So they want the government to provide a legal sanction around MSP. Although I understand that there has been a verbal assurance from government side regarding the MSP, but if you look at the two schemes, like the market intervention scheme and the PM Asha scheme, which are basically responsible for the implementation of MSP, so the budgetary allocation over the past 2 years, it has declined. So this is something which is really discouraging for the farming community. And so I would like to understand the government rationale or reasoning behind the same, and further, why is government apprehensive about providing a legal structure around the MSP?
First of all, the protest is about the three laws which have got passed. Please sit down. Three laws which have been passed. And the three laws which have been passed, there's nothing to do with MSP at all. So, if you want the three laws to be discussed, and if the protest is about some features within the three laws, yes, the government is willing to talk. And that is why even in the Lok Sabha, when I was replying on the budget, I said, please tell me which of the three, or which point within any one of the three laws is hurtful to the farmer. So that is one issue. And since MSP is not part of the three laws, to come and protest against the three laws and then raise MSP is a bit, for me, doesn't add up. Never mind. The minister, agriculture minister, sat and discussed with the farmers, saying, look, MSP is not a part of these three laws. You still want to discuss it? What is it? Then, now the question of, aside from the three laws, why don't we put MSP into a kind of a statute? And I'm sorry, I don't know where you got the figures from. MSP related data have been clearly read out in the parliament by the minister concerned, by me. It's not just any rise. It's a phenomenal increase in the number, both of the farmers who have benefited from MSP and the monies that they've received as procurement minimum support price. And it is not just for wheat and paddy, it's for wheat, paddy, bajra, jowar, pulses, jute, cotton. There are 22 items in that list of MSP, many of them don't even receive. And I'm sure you saw it in the papers in the last three days. MSP related procurement by NAFED is there, online available, but farmers are not coming because outside in the market, they are getting much higher rate than the MSP. So, MSP success, if you were to call that, what is MSP? It just gives a minimum floor price. If prices fall below this, here we are, you take the MSP. If the prices are prevailing higher than that in the market, and if the farmer doesn't turn up to take MSP, it's not the failure of MSP, it is actually that the MSP is held strongly, the prices are above it, the farmer benefits from that, and therefore MSP does not have to be extended. Now, so the question of put the MSP in the statute is got to be read and understood in this context. If indeed MSP has to be put in the statute, and this is a big whataboutery, universities and students don't like it, but I will engage in it. If indeed MSP has to be a part of the statute, given a law-based backing, why wasn't it felt during the 10 years of UPA? One. And why wasn't it ever an issue of discussion for farm reforms, agri reforms? No manifesto carried it till now. And I don't want to speculate as to why that has become an issue now, when actually the protests were on three farm laws, which has nothing to do with MSP. And you are asking of a government to ensure MSP through law. Which government between 2014 and 19 today has given maximum through MSP? Maximum. The coverage for more crops, and not just confining for wheat and paddy. The rate each season well in time, announced for Kharif, for Rabi, announced well in time and not in the nick of the moment, so the farmer doesn't know what he's going to get at the end of the day, but well in advance. So, handling of MSP, fixing of a proper MSP rate, announcing it well in time for both the crops separately within a year, bringing the coverage of more crops than just paddy and wheat, on all scores, our government has proven record to say, here we go, tell me where are we lagging behind. So what is the issue here? And even as I say, what is the issue here? I wonder what is actually the issue.
Hi ma'am, this is Yash, second year student here. Ma'am, I have two quick questions. One, this budget announced bad bank, which was a proposal floated by the former chief economic advisor Arvind Subramaniam much earlier, but there were no takers, I assume, at that time. So why now? And secondly, Subramaniam Swamy from your political party has batted for removal of income taxes at quite a few occasions. Wanted to know what is your take on that, especially given the fact that the salaried class bears the burden of it the most. So.
I have not announced any bad bank. So when you say why now, I don't know what you're talking about. What actually I have announced is a holding company which will take the NPAs onto it as per some formula. The RBI is working together with the banks on it. And then there will also be a lot of private participation of asset alternative investment funds which will, through a process, try to bid for these bad assets and then give them a payment which in turn also will proportionally come to the banks. The formulation is very different. So that answers that. On the income tax, it doesn't matter what I feel, what I don't. But we've come up with this, with an alternative income tax, formulation through which people who have enjoyed or enjoying or continue to enjoy exemptions and any kind of benefits that they want can remain in the old scheme. And we've given the new scheme for direct taxation. I appreciate your point saying income taxpayers are very few in this country. My desire is that we should be able to expand the net. We should have more people coming into paying tax. But tax also should be simple and reasonable. There were days when I talk of license quota Raj, which is what we were getting out of and moving away completely from it. 90% was the income tax. Direct taxes went up to 90%. Whereas I'm glad to say, in each segment of the direct taxation, we are bringing it down, and you know the corporate tax was brought down to 15%. So, taxation with a principle which I think I read out in my July budget, or was it in February budget, talking about how taxation happened during olden days. It was a quote from the Raghuvamsa by a famous poet of the ancient era, Kalidasa, as how sun absorbs little water and moisture drops and then comes back with a huge cloud which gives us rain for the benefit of all. When sun absorbs little drops of moisture, nobody feels the pain. When huge clouds come and give us cooling rain, everybody benefits. That is exactly the principle with which we are going on in taxation. Many of the old burdens are yet to be removed. I concede that. We will have to bring it all down so that it is reasonable, justifiable, and bearable.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Sorry, we are running short of time, so we'll have to wind up the event now. It was a wonderful event. I recall 2018 academic year when the JSW School of Public Policy conducted a series of public lectures and classroom seminars conducted by the former Honorable President of India, Sri Pranab Mukherjee. Then we ran this whole event under the broad theme of public policy for inclusive development in India. It's been more than 1.5 years that we are again doing, conducting a public lecture series on campus physically with such a huge audience and an eminent personality among us. Thank you once again, Madam Finance Minister, for accepting our invitation, coming over here in person and having a conversation with our students, taking questions from the audience, tough questions, easy questions, everything. Thank you so much, Madam, for coming over here. I would also like to thank the entire administration team from IMA who have worked to put this event together, all the students, faculty, researchers, and all IMA community members who have come here for the event. Thank you so much. We have arranged for light refreshments outside of the venue. Please help yourself. Have a good evening, and thank you so much. Thank you.